here we have a very good case to, in fact, probe the connections between deep earth processes and more superficial processes. Of course, you all know the Mediterranean Sea and the overall subduction setting that in the converging context between Africa and Europe. And within this context, you can also observe some more complexity and, in particular, a strong dichotomy between Eastern and Western Mediterranean. In Eastern Mediterranean, you still have an old oceanic crust of Mesozoic age, whereas in the Western Mediterranean Sea, you have a younger system inside this Tetisian system with a young Neogene crust. And this big difference between Eastern and Western Mediterranean is also shown here on a compilation from colleagues from Paris on the geothermal data that clearly show hotter settings in Western Mediterranean, whereas you have colder stuff in the Eastern Mediterranean. And so this is also shown on dynamic topography modeling, and that also show a clear differences between the two domains with some differences between the different models, but I'm not gonna go into the detail of that, of course. Now, I'm gonna concentrate on the western part, which is the purpose of this talk. And in this area, we had the chance to be part of a large program in France that was ongoing since the years 2000, the GDRMAGE and ActionMAGE program that bring together a large amount of people working first in the limited area in the Gulf of Lyon and through the years to the larger Western Mediterranean part. And within this context, I told you the general margin setting is that you have the opening of the Corsico-Sardinia block, and this is the magnetic map and a reconstruction, and through the from Oligocene time, opening of the margin and the creation in the middle here with the magnetic anomalies of these truly oceanic domains in the middle. So within this landlocked basin, we have, due to the rotation of this Corsico-Sardinia margin, we have a large amount of sediment supply coming from the Rhone River that is draining the Alpine domain. And this sediment supply is, of course, accumulating within this deep basin. And providing a nice archive of all the history of the margin hidden here in the sediments. And if we are able to understand them and describe them properly, we'll be able to reconstruct the whole history of the margin. So another specific event within the Mediterranean Sea is, of course, the Messinian event, which is an extreme event occurring around 6 million years in the Mediterranean Sea and leading to a major drawdown of the sea level and a major flooding back of the sea level in this area. And this, the detail of this is strongly debated. There are lots of models, lots of scenarios still going on. And one of the reasons of that is that we are still lacking some sampling of this deepest central basin, the deepest basin in Western and also in Eastern area. So, but in any case, what we have here is extreme mass transfer, extreme sea level drawdown, more than 1 kilometer, probably 1.5 kilometer of a sea level fall, a large amount of detritic, of course, because of the huge erosion of the margin here, deposited at the bottom of the margin, huge evaporite deposition within the deepest basin also, and a huge reflooding at the end of the crisis. So all these involves huge huge amount of mass transfer, and of course, strong consequences on isostatic rebound of the margin. In this area, we also have the chance to have access to a huge data set through the general program I was talking to you about. And this data set is made of several kinds of data sets of seismic data, from conventional seismic resolution to high resolution to very high resolution, coming from both industry and academia. And this enables to fully describe the geometries within this this area, and to fully understand the margin going from very deep context crustal description geometries of the margin using refraction data towards the description of the sedimentary pile, the seismic stratigraphy of the margin, up to shallower climatic studies of the Quaternary and Holocene deposits in there. And the combination of all those enables to have a full understanding of the of what's occurring in this basin. But there are some remaining unknowns, of course. And here you have a general line going across the Gulf of Lyon here, where you see the very thick pile here in front of the Rhone, a very thick pile of sediments up to in this area, it's up to 8 kilometers of sediments with Plio-Quaternary, the salt layer in the middle, and then all the layers below the salt that are still unsampled. Nobody ever drilled through those deposits in the Western Mediterranean. So we don't know the timing of all the events and the nature of all the sediments, and the same for the crustal area. So going back into more detail in those unknowns, the only thing we know is from indirect information, but we do have some information from the deep structure, and here is the position of some refraction data that was shot in the years 2006 in both the Gulf of Lyon and the Sardinia margin, and this gives an overall view of the organization of the margin with the thinning of the crust toward the deepest domain, and the same on the Sardinia margin. The interpretation of those lines enabled to differentiate different domains from onshore domain, unthinned continental crust, toward the thin autochthonous domain with a thin continental crust, and towards the oceanic domain I was showing you at the beginning with the magnetic anomalies. And in between those two domains, there's an allotolous domain, a transitional domain with anomalous velocity zones in this area. And the same organization is seen on the Sardinia margin, but with shallower, a narrower domain. And here's the position of the drill site we would like to do to reach and sample this anomalous zone, velocity zone, this allotolous domain that is of unknown nature. And doing reaching this, we would also go through all the sediments, the Miocene sediments above, and be able to define their paleoenvironments and their dating to reconstruct all the history of the margin, and in particular the subsidence history of the margin, and the vertical movement of the margin. And concerning this aspect, we have a number of evidence to show that there are really strong vertical movement in the margin. The first evidence comes from the observation of a major erosional surface at the beginning of the history. And this surface is of Aquitanian age, which show that the margin was still in a high position during this time, and that all the margin tilted and the subsidence occurred after this event. Another way to quantify and measure this subsidence is on the shelf and looking at sediments. Here you see the erosional surface, the Messinian erosional surface there, and on top of that, nice cliniform prograding during the Plio-Quaternary time. And we used the top sets of those cliniforms to calculate the overall subsidence through time. And this gave us an amount of 250 meters per million year at the edge of the shelf here, about 70 kilometers from the present-day coast. And this was also the same figure obtained on a very higher resolution scale using the glacial interglacial erosional surface, so giving the same amount of subsidence for the last half million years also. So a constant plioquaternary subsidence here on the shelf. So here also a large amount of subsidence, and here I talk about total subsidence, just observed tilting of the margin. Important subsidence here on the margin, and this work was extended by Estelle Leroux during her, her PhD work towards the slope and towards the deep basin by correlating all those stratigraphic markers, and she was able to show that we had three main domains, the shelf domain I was talking to you about, and she did the work in 3D in this area, and also the slope with a different amount of tilting and with a hinged zone in between the two zones, and the deepest domain where all the subsidence occurs vertically, basically, because all the surface are horizontal. And by looking back to the geophysical data there, we realized and were able to correlate those three domains with the main domain I was talking to you at the beginning between the unthinned continental crust, the thin continental crust, the strongly thin and the transitional zone and oceanic domain that both correspond to the vertical subsidence of the area here. So this is the residue in 3D, those different domains with the hinge loans between the tilting of the margin and the horizontally subsiding zone here in this area. So from there, you see already that there's a strong correlation between the deep domain, the deep structure of the margin and its consequences up to the present-day organization of the margin, organization of the stratigraphic seismic markers. So a strong deep and surface connection here in this area. Another fact that we were able to quantify is the measure of the Messinian isostatic ribbon here on the shelf using still, in this case, the seismic markers in the area, and looking at the Meissen seismic markers, because on this seismic line, you see that they're all horizontal. And just before, I told you that we could measure a plioquaternary tilting of the margin here. So we interpreted these markers as being horizontal because they had been tilted again during the Messinian, but they were uplifted during the Messinian because of the removal of such a large amount of sediments here on the shelf. So you had an isostatic uplift during the Messinian, and in this case, it just occurred to just compensate the plioquaternary subsidence. So we suggest that the amount of uplift in this area is up to 1.3 kilometers of uplift during the Messinian, so during less than 1 million years. So this is a really huge, large amount of vertical movement here and occurring in a very short amount of time. So as a sort of summary, the work we did through the years were identification of those seismic markers. We're also able to quantify the sedimentary fluxes here in the area using the volumes of sediment deposited in the deep basin, and the quantification of subsidence I was showing you just previously, and some modeling, also testing those hypotheses to be able to reproduce the observation on the seismic. But as you also can see here on these time scales, is that we're still missing some information in the Miocene data with markers correlated throughout the area and well dated, because there's no dates in the deep basin, so no wells. So this is why we really feel that having this deep core in the deep basin would better enable to detail all those this history in the basin here. So the history of this drilling project is quite a long history. It started in the years 2006. I'm not going to go into the detail of all this, but the end of the story is, well, not the end, I hope. Is in last April, we submitted a pre-proposal to IODP. That was called the Dream Gold Pre 857A pre-proposal, and we received a positive recommendation to submit a full proposal. So now we're in the process of better defining objective, better defining the strategy of the drilling and exploiting the result into a full proposal that we will submit in the 1st of April. So just to show you how we picked the our best candidate here for the drill site location, here again you have the large seismic data, and the two blue lines are the Sardinia lines, and we took the site at the crossings of those two lines. And here is how it looks on the two Sardinia lines. So you go through the old part. It's a little bit thinner than the other line I was showing you, because in this area we only have 6 kilometers of sediments on top of the deepest crustal structure. So we go through the salt and the subsalt sediments with the limit of the Messinen, which is not yet well defined. People disagree, still disagree on the position of the beginning of the Messinen. Some colleagues put it there, others put it lower down, so there's still arguments about that, which would be important because that would change the mass transfers of all the story, and we need also, of course, the timing of those all those events. So that's the same kind of schematic figure of the drill organization going through a quaternary, Pliocene, the Messinian units with the uncertainty that I was talking to you about, and then pre-Messinian deposits, and down to the crustal nature of the of the crust. So basically, our aim is to sample and construct the entire geodynamic history of the Gulf of Lions Sardinia margin system, including a better understanding of the Messinian salinity crisis, timing and chronology. And but all of this is to answer the basic question of the what are the mechanisms underlying those spectacular vertical motion that we can observe in the basin, in this basin in particular, but in the basins in general, and their margin. And the drilling, the IODP, and probably completed by ICDP drilling, would bring constraints on this the crustal structure and the better define the thermomechanical and mechanical modeling and properties of the lithosphere in a process-oriented and ground-truth approach. So the first part of the drilling targets more superficial processes and will enable to define the chronology, the lithology, the paleoenvironment, and the paleoclimatic context of these deposits below the salt in the deep basin, and that would also enable to backstrip the whole history of the margin. And the second part will go into deeper processes to better understand the conjugate rifting system, sample the transitional crust to see its nature and the its consequences on the dynamics of the history and the exchanges, the thinning processes, and the consequences on the sedimentary filling. And the combination of those two parts will provide insights into the subsidence and isostatic adjustment history of the of this Gulf of Lions Sardinia margin system to better understand the concept of deep surface deep and surface connections. So as I told you, the SEP recommended development of a full proposal to better investigate the mechanism underlying the vertical motion in basin in general. So the full proposal is in progress, and we will submit it by the 1st of April. And this general IODP, very deep basin proposal, is accompanied by other kinds of projects. We are thinking about an ICDP proposal in the Rhone Graben to complement the information of the deep a basin, offshore basin, and some more analogic and numerical and modeling to better test and predict maybe the lithologies and the behavior of the basin before the drilling, and additional cruises, offshore cruises, to better define the context in the area. So this is the same thing again with the different themes that are, I guess, the geodynamic context and deep processes understanding, the Messinian salinity crisis. There's an additional interest into the deep biosphere within this deep drilling to look for bacteria and archaea within the sediments and in a special context with very high pressure, high temperature, and in a salt and salty context, and also with the salt tectonics and fluids in circulation in basin, basically. And this will going to be the link with the next talk given by Francisco Sierro. The GOLD project is in fact part of a larger umbrella project called MDP 857 that aims to uncovering the salt giants. And so everything I told you is related to target A here, the deep basin sampling, but there are additional targets to fully understand the Messinian salinity crisis in the Western Mediterranean basin, but we would also like to go to Eastern Mediterranean basin where the Messinian history and the salt deposit is not exactly the same, so we have to understand the difference between the two basins. Okay, thank you.
So we have ample time for questions. And
I don't think... now it is working. I like the idea also to first give the floor to some junior scientists. And it's early and it's maybe difficult even, but I'm going to try anyway. Ah, sorry, yes.
I'm very interested in the Mediterranean, obviously, but I have some questions. You draw some seismic reflectors between the mobile unit and the basement. Hmm. And of course, there is this still the problem, where do you put in seismics the limit of the lower evaporites? What are the constraints for drawing these, let's say, lines? Do they, is it a biostratigraphy attached to it? Most probably not, because it was not drilled, right?
Yeah. Yeah, the like on this figure, is okay? Yeah. I can put the other one. Yeah, that's the major problem. There's no biostratigraphy in the deep basin, so all we can do is have the lines. There are some wells on the shelf and on the upper slope, basically. The deepest well is GLP-2 well, and it was done at 1,600 meters water depth, so on the slope, but then in an area where all this big series is pinching out. Yeah. So then you have just a tiny thing, and the constraints, the chronostratigraphic constraints, especially for the below the salt units, is not good. It's not good enough. So basically, it's a physical correlation of surface down to the deep basin, but so, then...
I mean, I don't want to offend nobody, but it's just like it's the best guess that you would have for these reflectors, that these very, I don't know, high reflectance ones, just below the mobile, you think that it's the gypsum.
Yeah, we think it's gypsum, but probably not only gypsum, but gypsum with
marl
and shale and argil and so on. So, and we don't really know. That's the thing. And this is what I would like also to do before April, also with my colleagues from IFP, is that to run specific modeling to better constrain test the lithologies here to see what would be the doing some seismic synthetics using different lithological columns to you know, try to see if we could have the same seismic signature with a gypsum only, with alternating gypsum and shale, with a dolomite maybe in between, a bit of carbonate, and just to, but it's only guess because nobody went through that here. Yeah,
and
in the
are you really thinking of drilling 9 kilometers of sediment?
It's not nine in this area, it's six.
Oh, sorry, it's only six.
It's
so
only six.
It's only six,
no. Yeah? But we're going to skip the Plio-Quaternary, unfortunately. It would be interesting, of course, also. But and also, because it's using the Chukyu vessel, then you need a big casing. So the first kilometer, anyway, is off.
Ruined, yeah.
And so, but we'll have to skip that. And then we would start in the upper evaporite. Okay. And not call all the salts neither, because it would be only salts, and people are very interested in salt. But we would do probably some spot coring in the salts, and then try to better core the end. But then it's going to be more difficult to core. So the deeper you go, the more difficult it is. So it's not, it won't be a full nice like coring as they use for paleoclimate, where they do three holes at the same place, but it would get information and constraints.
Yeah, I think that also what you can use is in the Eastern Mediterranean, there are these already, I think that some, I don't know, 367, 376, whatever, or 374, mm-hmm. they reach the salt. Yeah. And then, I mean, the halite unit. So I think that's something that the people could learn from, say, drilling such a thing.
Yeah. But that did not go through the salt. No. The petroleum industry did, but then it's difficult to have information on that. So they went through it because they find all below the, and within this, the salt within unit and below. Sorry? No, yeah, that's life.
Maybe something to add for the people who are not so familiar with this type of a problem. The reason why the Messinian deposits have not been cored thus far is that it technically is very challenging, and that's why this special ship is also needed. It the casing to prevent blowouts. So it's also at the technological level, it's quite exciting to do this. Other questions?
No, I wanted to add also a similar type of comment, more than a question. You were showing these different interpretations, these different stratigraphic models for the Messinian salinity crisis, and very briefly mentioning where does this come from. Essentially, from the lack of correlation between the deep and the continental outcrops, no?
Yeah.
But I think there is another reason, and that we have to add. And for me, this was also a reason to try to bring together Topo-Europe and the Messinian salinity crisis here. I think we have a lack of people thinking in terms of processes at the scale of the Mediterranean and trying to see what are the possible scenarios, not just what are the data and how do they correlate, but also thinking in terms of geodynamics at the seaways, at the corridors. And there is very few people like Rob Hofers who has been doing this. I think there is a lack of this. And I hope really that we somehow come closer together in this respect.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Danny.
Yes. I'm just interested by the 1.3 kilometers of erosion that you've got on the shelf edge. How well is that documented? And presumably that, I just want a clarification on the sort of uplift, the rock uplift signal response to that and the evidence for it.
Okay, so it's not exactly the erosion. I suggest that there's 1.3 kilometers of uplift because I measure after the Messinian 1.3 kilometers of subsidence during the Plio-Quaternary. That brings back the Miocene markers back to horizontal. And the erosion, on the other hand, the erosion was also quantified using the area where the sediment are preserved in some area. They're less eroded, let's say. And then if you try to draw back the image before the erosion, then you can measure an amount of at least 900 meters of erosion from this, with a conservative estimate, because then you don't know if the preserved part has been eroded or not. So this is so this was also done in another way. So the kilometric scale erosion and uplift, I think, is now rather well documented according on observation using sediment markers.
Okay. Well, I think.
I think it's maybe also important to mention that the different communities involved in scientific drilling now come closer together, both drilling in the marine domain and in the continental domain. And of course, I think it's wonderful that we now bring in closer the marine story and the continental story. And of course, in that context, I think it's the right time, also in view of the results of previous Topo-Europe projects and Topo-Europe projects in the future. And this is a unique opportunity now. I think you're very brave in developing this. And ICDP is of course much more low-cost operation than the ocean drilling. I think it's a very good idea to do some continental drilling in the area surrounding the basin.
Well, thank you, Sierd. I think we should move on. Thank you.